Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info.
In part two of this presentation, physicist Wal Thornhill continues his discussion of the recent discovery of a so-called shocking electric wind at the planet Venus. As described in the previous episode, the electric wind is said to be sufficiently strong that it can strip an entire planet of all its water components. The co-author of a study on the discovery said of these findings, "It's amazing and shocking. We never dreamt an electric wind could be so powerful that it can suck oxygen right out of an atmosphere into space. This is something that has to be on the checklist when we go looking for habitable planets around other stars." But as Wal Thornhill explains, neither this nor countless other surprising discoveries has freed planetary scientists from their ideas about the history of the solar system, including the notions of how life arose on Earth and could arise on other planets.
I answered in detail in June 2004 the question, why doesn't Venus have much water, in my article Cassini's Homecoming. It was written to coincide with that amazing spacecraft's arrival at the ringed giant Saturn. The simple answer is that Venus hasn't been around long enough to lose an ocean of water, so its puzzling heavy carbon dioxide atmosphere requires a very different explanation. Likewise, it is nowhere admitted that according to the standard model, the Earth should not have oceans of water either, because hydrogen would have been blown out of the inner solar system early in the Sun's assumed career. However, all observations in the space age show the solar system to be a blended family of odd bodies, each with their own story. Nothing is to be gained by trying to force-fit them to a centuries-old evolution-in-place theory, with all of the hypothetical collisional drama occurring billions of years ago. That might make us feel safe, but it has nothing to do with science. Meanwhile, gravitational systems, as presently understood, are inherently unstable. Something is seriously wrong. So, back to these electric winds stripping planets of oceans and atmospheres. Velikovsky's identification of Venus as an electrically discharging comet was spot on. The problem of how a comet that size can end up in the most circular orbit of any of the planets has had to wait for the electric universe explanation of the electrical nature of mass and gravity. It provides the essential feedback mechanism to establish and maintain clockwork stability. As a comet, Venus was discharging massively as a cathode in the solar discharge, and swiftly circularizing its orbit. As a planet, Venus still discharges 5 times more strongly than the Earth. The electrons leaving Venus drag along positive oxygen ions to a degree that was unexpected. But the euphemism electric wind means an electric discharge, like an air ionizer. It's an electric current. This is confirmed by the twisted magnetic flux ropes, known more correctly as Birkeland currents by plasma physicists, identified in the cometary tail of Venus. That tail still stretches to tickle the Earth at inferior conjunction. That's a mechanism that determines the spacing of orbits. It's true that this gradual loss of atmosphere and water over eons poses a problem for life on Earth-like planets. It shows the folly of assuming, in typical geocentric fashion, that life in the universe is to be found in a narrow Goldilocks zone about a bright star. It's not a good situation to be in, either for the establishment of life or its long-term survival. The electric universe shows instead that all stars are a form of low-pressure electrical gas discharge phenomenon in a galactic circuit. Red stars of all sizes are those that have expanded their glowing plasma sheaths in order to collect enough electrons from the interstellar plasma to satisfy their discharge requirements. That's why red giants are observed to expand and contract in response to changes in their electrical environment. But it's inside the glowing red spheres of brown dwarf stars that orbiting satellites find conditions best suited for life. Every square meter of each satellite's surface receives the same radiant energy. There are no seasons. Most significantly, recent observations show water and other molecules necessary for life are found in the spectra of brown dwarfs, and those molecules will mist down on the satellites, establishing oceans and atmospheres. Significantly, ferns are adapted to misting rain, and red light is the most conducive to photosynthesis. and water, which is essential to life, is activated electrically by infrared light or warmth. So it makes sense that brown dwarfs should be considered as the most likely candidates for cosmic wombs, not bright stars like the Sun. This raises many issues in the search for life elsewhere in the universe. Perhaps most important is that the search for extraterrestrial intelligence, or SETI, is doomed to failure because radio waves cannot penetrate the glowing plasma shell of a red star, and the chances of intelligent life happening to survive being torn from its brown dwarf womb in a capture event like that suffered by the Earth and Mars seems remote. In fact, Mars stands as mute testimony to the devastation that we narrowly avoided. It is our closest relative in the solar system and shared the same cosmic womb. This much is made remarkably clear by applying a forensic approach to all of the evidence available from human observations of the skies over millennia. Of course, none of this information is deducible from the narrow deductive perspective of a modern cosmology, which has no interest in history and denies any electrical involvement in the celestial mechanism. Thankfully, in this age of instant global communication, we may not have to wait centuries for a paradigm shift.
For continuous updates on space news from the Electric Universe, stay tuned to thunderbolts.info.